Hey everyone, Jason Schappert here of MzeroA.com, back with you in part 3 of 4 of our 7700 series for Facebook and YouTube. More great content on the podcast. Online ground school members are getting 2 great webinars a week now on Tuesday afternoon. So just some great content out there for you all. Also, don't forget about the live stream at the end of this month. Today we're talking about Air China 006. And this accident, or I guess really incident, has no fatalities to really relate to, but it again, it relates so well to United Flight 173 in the sense that even professionals make mistakes. I'll set it up for you as we simulate everything, so let's dive into that here now. The aircraft had departed Taipei at 16:22 local time. The accident occurred 10 hours into the flight. The Boeing 747 was just 350 miles northwest of San Francisco, cruising at an altitude of 41,000 feet. The captain had 15,500 flight hours. The first officer, more than 7,700 flight hours. And the flight engineer had approximately 15,500 hours of flight time. The accident occurred while the main crew was on duty in this situation here. Obviously, on this long of a flight, we have a relief crew here as well. But the main crew, all those hours, all that experience, was flying at the time. The sequence began with a loss of thrust to the number 4 engine. That engine had failed twice during previous flights, while it cruised at 41,000 and 43,000 feet. In each of those cases, the engine was restarted after descending to a lower altitude. The maintenance response to the logbook entries that noted the problems included things like an engine inspection, fuel filter drainage and replacement, vane controller inspection and replacement, water drainage from the mock probes, and other filter replacements. None of those acts fixed the recurrent problem of the number 4 engine. The flight engineer attempted to restore power to the engine, but didn't close the bleed valve as required by the checklist procedure. After the flight engineer announced the engine had flamed out, the captain instructed him to restart it and ordered the first officer to request a clearance for a descent from 41,000 feet. According to the flight manual, engine restart is unlikely to succeed above 30,000 feet. The attempt failed. Meanwhile, airspeed is continuing to decrease. The autopilot has rolled the control wheel to the maximum left limit of 23 degrees as the speed decreases even further. The plane begins to roll to the right, even though the autopilot was maintaining the maximum left roll limit. By the time the captain disconnects the autopilot, the airplane had rolled over 60 degrees to the right, and the nose is beginning to drop. Ailerons and flight spoilers were really the only means available for the autopilot to keep the wings level, as the autopilot does not connect to the rudder during normal flight. To counteract the asymmetrical forces created by the loss of thrust from the number 4 engine, it was essential for the pilot to manually push on the left rudder. However, the captain failed to use any rudder inputs at all before or after disconnecting the autopilot. So imagine that now. The autopilot has its maximum left limit of 23 degrees. It's just to kind of hold off this 60 degree bank to the right with the nose dropping. You disconnect the autopilot, take away the 23 degrees of pressure in the other direction. Where's that nose going to really snap around to now? And your feet are flat on the floor. You're not even applying any rudder pressure. You see where this is going to end up, and you see this, how this little kind of cloud layer here, spatial disorientation, is starting to set in. Our story continues. As the plane descends through the clouds, the captain's attention was drawn to the attitude indicator, which displayed excessive bank and pitch. Because the attitude was so irregular, the captain incorrectly assumed the indicators to be faulty. So without visual reference due to the clouds and having rejected the information on the attitude indicators, there's many, the captain and first officer experienced spatial disorientation. His attitude indicator was literally, I mean, picture it, just pointing at the earth, essentially, just about upside down. And he looks at it and goes, there's no way. Something must be wrong with the attitude indicator. That's not even a possible value to show up on an attitude indicator. There's no way the airplane is in that situation right now. It must be wrong. literally, that's what he was quoted as saying. I thought the attitude indicator was just incorrect, that it too was faulty. And thus the story continues. Only after breaking through the bottom of the clouds at 11,000 feet was the captain able to orient himself and bring the airplane under control, leveling out at 9,600 feet. They had descended 30,000 feet in 2 minutes, while all on board experienced G-forces as high as 5 Gs. There are actually reports of a broken ankle and severe bruising and head trauma from the passengers on board. The cockpit crew had believed that all four engines had flamed out, but the NTSB found that only engine number 4 had failed. After leveling out, the 3 remaining engines were supplying normal thrust. A restart attempt brought number 4 back to use. They began climbing and reported to air traffic control the condition was now normal, because obviously they were asking, and they wished to continue on to Los Angeles. However, they noticed now their landing gear was down and the main hydraulic system was empty. The G-forces were so abrupt, it literally ripped the landing gear down into place and sucked out all of the hydraulic fluid. Now, because they didn't have sufficient fuel to reach Los Angeles with this increased drag, because they couldn't bring the gear up either, they diverted to San Francisco, where they declared an emergency and the plane landed without further incident. However, let me show you a photo of the plane, and you're going to wonder, how did it even land? There's our horizontal stabilizer missing 40% of it, just broken off. They were lucky they could even flare in that land in that 747 just to do that. 5 Gs, the crew and the passengers all experienced, literally breaking bones. It was so abrupt. Here's a 747 just about upside down, losing 30,000 feet in 2 minutes. So let me ask you that. Why did Air China lose 31,000 feet in under 2 minutes? Was it just because it was a rapid descent? Was it because they lost engine number 4? Was it because of poor CRM? What was the issue here? Let me know in the comment box. I want to know that, but I would argue maybe it was lack of experience. Maybe their instruments were wrong. I don't think it was any of those things. I mean, maybe those play a little role, but their instruments weren't wrong. They were shown the truth. I don't think it was a lack of experience, because this crew had a lot, 15,000 flight hours the captain had, and still susceptible to spatial disorientation. I think they had a syntax error. What's a syntax error? My IT professionals know what a syntax error is. I can have all the right ingredients, but something's done in the wrong order. Well, our syntax error started very early on when they tried to restart at 41,000 feet when the flight manual said, no, it needs to be done at 30,000 feet. They did all the right things. They just did it in the wrong environment, perhaps, causing an error. From there, they just fell behind the airplane and that descent continued and they weren't flying the airplane. You hear me say this so often. I wish every single student would learn to fly like an old J3 Piper Cub. And then, for your instrument, step up to the beautiful Avionine systems or G1000 systems, whatever you're flying, then step up to all that amazing technology so you have a skill set, some stick and rudder skills to truly fall back on. That's just one man's professional opinion, though I know not everybody follows that. So leave me a comment below this video. Why did Air China lose 31,000 feet in about 2 minutes? Listen, I also hope you'll join me March 26th for our JFK Jr. Live recreation. We're going to show you everything here, brand new simulations, everything else, some great new content. It's March 26th at 3 p.m. on the MzeroA.com YouTube or Facebook pages. Please be sure to subscribe and like those pages so you get those updates. RSVP is in the description below. Also, Sun and Fun. If you'll be at Sun and Fun, it's coming up too here, we'll be in Hangar D, Hangar Delta at 12 p.m. on the Saturday of Sun and Fun. My good friend Steve Oncanivo will also be in the booth as well. Hope you'll swing by, say hi to him and myself as well. I'll be there all week though. Looking forward to seeing you all. Can't wait to read your comments on Facebook, on YouTube, on MzeroA.com. Enjoy the rest of your day, and most importantly, remember, But a good pilot is always learning. Have a great day, guys. We'll see ya. Take a 2-week free trial of our online ground school and see why Aviation Consumer Magazine named it the top online ground school on the market. The first thing you'll notice is that we never teach to the test. We teach real world skills that are going to keep you and your loved ones safe when you fly. Now, it's because of this real world teaching, you'll pass your knowledge test and your check ride with flying colors. With one membership, you get access to all our courses, plus weekly webinars with myself and this outstanding MzeroA.com team. It's really like an interactive TV show broadcast from our studio, where you get to interact with a team of CFIs. We also offer live support and email support to make sure you succeed. Now, one thing you'll notice is that MzeroA is like nothing else on the market. It is truly a flight training community geared towards making you a safer, smarter pilot, because a good pilot is always learning. It's much more than a slogan for us. It is truly a mission. So click below and take a 2-week, no strings attached trial of our top rated private, instrument, commercial, and FOI courses. Once you join our flight training community, I promise you will never want to leave.